الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد. Continuing on in our lesson in the Islamic Creed by Sheikh Ahmed Al-Atiq, hafidhahullah ta'ala, we reached the chapter 15 where the Sheikh was talking about hypocrisy. And he mentioned that hypocrisy is of two types. He said the major hypocrisy and the minor hypocrisy. And the major hypocrisy is hypocrisy in belief, in which a person exhibits Islam and conceals disbelief. And this is the type of hypocrisy that spells one from the religion in totality. So when a person has this type of hypocrisy, where they, what is contained in their heart differs from what is on their outside appearance. For example, they have the appearance that they are believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but yet, and that they're with the believers and helping and supporting the believers, but in fact, they hate Islam and they do not believe in Islam, do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do not believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nor the prophetic sunnah alayhi salatu wa salam. So these people will be in the lowest depths of the fire, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the hypocrites all throughout the Quran, and in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, في كتابه الكريم قال إن الذين كفروا سواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون ختم الله على قلوبهم وعلى سمعهم ولا سمعهم وعلى أبصارهم غشاوة ولهم عذاب عظيم ومن الناس من يقول آمنا بالله وباليوم الآخر وما هم بمؤمنين يخادعون الله والذين آمنوا وما يخدعون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا ولهم عذاب عليم بما كانوا يكذبون إلى آخر آية. So Allah Tabarak Ta'ala mentions in the Quran about the hypocrites, and in Surah Al-Baqarah he mentions that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, verily those who disbelieve, regardless of whether you called them or you didn't call them, they wouldn't believe. So regardless of whether you propagated the message to them or not, they're not going to believe. Their hearts are hard. Their hearts are sealed. And this is the case of the hypocrites, is that and those who are staunch and arrogant on disbelief, is that they'll never believe. No matter if you try to give them dawah and you try to, and even if they're in the gatherings of the believers, they won't change because their hearts are sealed. في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. In their hearts is a sickness, and so Allah increases the sickness. Why? It's because of their own deeds. It's because they refuse to believe because of their arrogance and their hypocrisy. So Allah leaves them in that hypocrisy and allows them to continue in their hypocrisy, and they will be in the lowest depths of the hellfire. So all that in the beginning, or in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the beginning, after mentioning the believers, Allah mentions those characteristics of the hypocrites, and that they are the people of the hellfire and will inherit the hell, will be in the hellfire forever and in the lowest depths of the hellfire. So all those ayats, after the first four or five ayats in Surah Al-Baqarah, which describe the believers, are a description of the hypocrites. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِن قال إنما نحن مسلمون ألا إنهم هم المفسدون لكن لا يشعرون. So if you say to them, don't cause fitna and destruction and facade in the earth and wickedness in the earth, they say no, إنما نحن مسلمون, verily we are the people who spread peace, and we're the people who spread goodness, and we're the people who want sulh, we want this peace and harmony in the earth. And then Allah says, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Verily, they are the mufsidun. They're the ones who cause this facade and cause this wickedness. وَلَكِنْ they don't even realize it. And they don't even realize it. وَعِيَاذَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. May Allah protect us from being of the hypocrites. May Allah bless us with ikhlas, with the bad al-sunnah. So this is the case and the affair of the hypocrites. The Shaykh goes on to mention, hypocrisy is of six types. He says, number one, to disbelieve in the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a person who disbelieves in the messenger, regardless if they say la ilaha illallah, but they disbelieve in what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. They disbelieve in the message. They disbelieve in the Quran. They disbelieve in anything that is authenticated in the sunnah, and they are aware of its authenticity, and then they reject it, then this is disbelief. And they say, no, 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 I don't believe it. I know the Prophet ﷺ said, يَنْزُلُ رَبُّنَا تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى كُلُّ ثُلُثَ اللَّيْلَ الْآخِرَ. I believe that it's a sahih hadith. I believe that it's a sound and authentic hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah descends to the lowest heavens every third of the night, but my intellect rejects it. So I reject it. I don't believe in that. That doesn't fit with my aql. That doesn't fit with my intellect. So this right here is a very dangerous ground. I'm not making takfir of the person who says this, but on the zahir of what we see, that's kufr. So we have to be very careful of not rejecting something that has been authenticated by the Prophet sallallahu narrated, that's an authentic narration on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to be cautious. So we believe in the Messenger of Allah. The hypocrites, one of the types of hypocrisy is that they disbelieve in the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second type is to disbelieve in some of what the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent with. So disbelieving in some of the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the major hypocrisy which expels one from the fold of Islam. Wa'iyadhu billahi min dhalika. The third type of hypocrisy is hatred for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa'iyadhu billah. May Allah bless us to love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam truly, not just saying that on our tongues, but by truly following his sunnah, because we have so many shortcomings. We're so weak. And we always, many of us, we claim the sunnah. We yell sunnah. You know, and I'm including myself first and foremost. I'm talking about myself. That we have to be cautious about this. We have to be very careful. We say we're Ahlul Sunnah, but are we following the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah? That's how we should be testing ourselves. We should be waking up every day and say, well, how did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spend his nights? Was he doing what we did in the evening? Or was he Sallallahu Rabbi Wasallamu Alaihi? Was he busy with ilm, busy with the affairs of the Ummah? Was this, and what were we busy with? We should always be making comparison. We should always be looking at ourselves to check for any aspects of hypocrisy. But as far as the major hypocrisy, it is those people who have hatred for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or hatred for some of what he sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent with. The fifth thing is rejoicing at the belittlement of the religion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whenever you have someone that they, even if they claim and they say la ilaha illallah, when the Muhammad Rasulullah, they say the Shahada, the testimony of faith, but yet they are happy when Islam is belittled. They rejoice when Islam is, when you see the Muslims in a bad state. They actually feel good about this. Then this is the major hypocrisy that takes one out of the fold of Islam. We have to be cautious about this. We have to have love for the sake of Allah, and hatred for the sake of Allah, that we love those things that Allah loves, and we hate those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates kufr. He hates hypocrisy. He hates disbelief. He hates any and all kind of evil and munkarat. So we have to check ourselves, and we should be striving. We should hate those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates, and love those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. Allah loves the believers. Allah loves the mutatahirun. Allah loves the sabirun. So those people are patient. Those people are the purified ones. Allah loves them. Allah loves the believers. So we should love the believers. That is our aqidah. That's the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, is that we love what Allah loves and we hate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. And we rejoice at Islam being spread. When we hear that, mashallah, Islam is being spread in Europe, then we're happy. We're happy and rejoicing that more people are coming out of darkness to the light. They're leaving the darkness of Satan worship and all of these foreign ideologies that are destroying humankind. How is it now in America that people and all over the world, they're allowing men to marry men? This is the most strangest thing. This is unknown in history. Although those aspects of homosexuality were throughout history, but never has it been so widespread and open to where people are rejoicing that you will be persecuted if you speak out against homosexuality. If you say, even if you just say, I don't agree with it, people look at you strange. Now, this shows you we're in the end of time, that times are strange. This is something we can, our hearts become so attuned to this immorality and to wickedness that we begin to accept that, that we ourselves begin to say, well, you know, they're gay and those two men want to marry. I don't agree with it, but hey, whatever. That's how weak we are. But instead, we should hate that action in the heart because it goes against all the commandments. It goes against what the prophets were sent to the children of Israel, what they were sent with. It goes against their commandments. It goes against what Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, what he was sent with in the Bible. It goes against it. And it goes against what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent with because their message was the same. Their message was essentially the same, and it all was based upon the call to the worship of Allah alone, one God. We worship Allah. We worship Him and Him alone. Nothing is worthy of worship but Him. No partners. He has no partners. And so this is what we love, and we want to see the good. And so we have to avoid this trait of hypocrisy, which the hypocrites possess. They want to see Islam taht. They want to see Islam down. وَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. May Allah bless us with Jannah al-Firdaws and guidance. Ameen. The last type of hypocrisy, of the major type of hypocrisy the Shaykh went on to mention, was number 6. He said, dislike for the victory of the religion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whenever a person, you have people who claim Islam, but they say, hey, I don't want to practice the Sharia. I don't believe in the Sharia. The Sharia is not beneficial for us in this time. It's not beneficial for us in this society. It's not in it's not conducive to democratic ideas and ideology. Wow. This is something, it's not even worth commenting on, that you should check yourself. And Islam was sent, you know, sent. It was the message of all the Anbiya, of all the prophets, alayhim afdhal salatu wassalam. So anytime a person says these kind of things, they need to check their aqidah. Either they are so jahil and they need to be taught, or they are just straight disbelievers in Islam. They don't believe in Islam. So whatever, if your religion is democracy, that's your path. Lukum dinukum waliyadin. And my path is Islam. To you your way, and to us our way. Our religion is Islam. So those people who claim Islam, who are Muslim, that there's never can they worship the democratic gods. They can never, that's not the ideology, that is not the pillars of their society. Their society pillars are built upon Islam, upon Kitabillah wa Sunnah Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We can't vote it in. We can't vote in homosexuality this time. We can't vote in and just because a society decides, hey, it's okay to have pedophiles and their behavior. You know, we voted it. Now men can marry dogs. No, we can't accept that. Islam does not accept it. I'm sorry, there's no compromise in that. That's not from me. That's Islam. Islam is the haq. La ilaha illallah. Muhammad Rasulullah. That's what it is. So to accept other ideologies and to want to see Islam taht, to see Islam underneath those ideologies, this is hypocrisy. And we have to beware this. We have to beware that. We have to love Islam. We have to know Islam. If you know Islam, you will love Islam. Plain and simple. I don't have to tell you to love Islam. I'm not forcing you to do anything. I'm just telling you that Islam is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He legislated that for us. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ إِسْلَامَ دِينًا. Allah has perfected this religion for us, and He's legislated for that for us, that religion. So you should only want to see what Allah wants to be up high. You should never want something else to be over that. You should never say, oh, well, you know, hey, I'm from this country and I'm from that country. We have a communist ideology. We should have that instead, or above Islam, or equal to Islam. Abadan. No. That's mushmaqul. It's totally unacceptable and incomprehensible. Because if you study Islam, if you really study, I'm just asking those people who want to lift the ignorance from themselves, go to the books, go to the Quran. Just go to the Quran. And then go to the Sunnah and go to the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih. You will see there's no room for hypocrisy and and the haq, and the truth. So those are the types of hypocrisy. Then moving on to the minor hypocrisy, the Sheikh went on to say, the minor hypocrisy, that is performing any of the deeds of the hypocrites while having some faith in the heart. So it shows us, this is a very important point here, is that yes, Ahle Tawheed, Ahle Iman, sometimes we can have aspects of hypocrisy. We all have sins. As the Prophet ﷺ said, "Kullu ibn Adam khata wa khayran khata'ina tawabun." And there's many, so many ayats and hadith which illustrate for us that yes, we're sinners and we need to come back to Allah constantly, constantly seeking forgiveness. So it shows us that tawheed and shirk, at times, you can have aspects of shirk. A believer can fall into the minor shirk or even the major shirk and make tawbah from that and make repentance from that. It happens that in the heart we have the inclination to evil and good. The person can look all good and be on the sunnah, but they can go to some of the worst deeds. And opposite, a person could look like a wicked sinner and have no signs of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and go and be doing the best of deeds. So it shows us in the heart of the believer that there's always a striving and struggle. This is the hearts of all people, but you'll find that there's a striving. The shaitan whispers to you, and your intention, your nafs, your soul, your desires, they want you to, they're inclined towards evil. So you have to strive to overcome that. So at times the believer can have aspects of hypocrisy, but not be a hypocrite. So they're still a believer, but they have the minor hypocrisy. As he can still be a believer and have the minor shirk. As he can still be from Ahl Sunnah and fall into Hizbiyah. He can still be from Ahl Sunnah, espousing the principles of Kitab wa Sunnah. But they can fall into partisanship, into calling to him or herself, or his or her jama'at, or group of brothers and group of sisters, or just two or three ulama that they believe are the only ones on the Sunnah. That can happen to someone who is from Ahl Sunnah. So it shows us that we can have the traits of good and evil in our hearts, and we have to be cautious. We have to be cautious. So the minor hypocrisy, again, that is performing any of the deeds of the hypocrites while having some faith in the heart, like unfulfilling promises. So when we we don't fulfill our promises, that this is a sign of hypocrisy. Someone who's doing this on a regular basis, they keep, every time you make an appointment with them, he or she, they break their promise, okay? This is a sign of hypocrisy. It doesn't mean that person is a hypocrite. It means they've fallen into or they possess some characteristics of the minor hypocrisy because they're always not fulfilled. They never fulfill their promises. Another aspect is if they speak, when they speak, they lie, speaking lies. So when we lie, and we all fall into, as they say, those little white lies and those little black lies even, that we all fall into these lies. We all can fall into lying and maybe a situation and we, you know, because of our desires or whatever, we lie. We fall into a lie. So this is a sign of hypocrisy. Even though that person could be your imam, he could be your sheikh, he could be your the one you take your knowledge from or she could be the one who teaches you or whatever the case may be. But yes, they can fall into that and still be a believer. A believer who has naqs iman. Their iman is down when they do those sins. So the shahid, the point being here, is that speaking lies is a type of hypocrisy. It's a type of minor hypocrisy. Also, dishonesty regarding trust, not fulfilling your trust and your obligations. This is a type of hypocrisy, and may Allah forgive us for our shortcomings. Also, betrayal. Betrayal is a type of hypocrisy, the minor hypocrisy. Laziness and carelessness regarding the prayer. Aha, this is one that many of us fall into. It's time for Fajr. You never see them in the masjid. Or it's whatever the case is, they always are late. May Allah forgive us. Late for being in the first row. Always, they're always the one in the back of the masjid. They do pray. But because of their carelessness, they're always the ones looking at the back of other people's heads during the prayer. Why? Because they're late. And so carelessness and laziness with regarding the salat is a type of hypocrisy, a type of the minor hypocrisy. This type of hypocrisy does not expel someone from the religion, but it is a means, it's a wasila. as we talked about before in the previous stars, al-wasa'il laha ahkam al-maqasid, that when we, the means to something takes the same ruling as that. That's a Sharia principle. That when, so for example, the minor hypocrisy does not take you out of the fold of Islam, but it's a means to the major. So we have to be careful. So it's still a sinful thing. And whenever we do some, whenever we're trying to achieve a sinful aim, that means the means to it is sinful. Moving on to the next chapter, which is an incredibly important chapter, and we'll briefly go over it, and we have durus, separate lectures which are dedicated solely to this topic. Another treatise I've translated, and I will do it in the future, and I've done it in the past, that we will also do, which is regarding the nullifiers of Islam, and I've brought the explanations of many various scholars and some talabat al-ilm, and put it together to put what they, how they explain the nullifiers of faith, which are important for us all to be aware of. So the Sheikh went on to mention in chapter 16 the nullifiers of Islam, and he mentioned 10 of them, I believe. So the Sheikh went on to say, number one, associating partners in the worship of Allah. So shirk, committing shirk, is one of the things that nullifies your Islam, meaning the major shirk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ وَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرَ مَا دُونَ ذَلَكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ, that verily Allah does not, verily Allah does not forgive that you commit shirk with Him, associating partners, polytheism, but He forgives other than that for whomsoever He pleases. This is the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So shirk, the major shirk, takes you out of the fold of Islam and requires for you to make tawbah and come back to Islam. The second type of the second nullifier of Islam is whoever puts between himself and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an intermediary, supplicating to it and asking it for intercession and relying upon it. And this is something we've already mentioned in the previous lessons, is that whenever somebody seeks an intercessor between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is a type of shirk, and it takes you out of the fold of Islam. It's not permissible as a Muslim to go to the grave and pray to those dead people, the dead saints, even if you believe they're alive, they have a life in Barzakh, Nam, but we don't know how that life, the kayfiyah of Barzakh, we don't know anything, there's no dalil and no evidence to show that they can answer our dua or answer our supplications, nor can the Prophet ﷺ, there's no dalil that the Prophet ﷺ can answer our supplications and take them to Allah for us. We don't have that, nor was it the sunnah of the companions or the tabi'een or itba' tabi'een. It wasn't their sunnah. So to put an intercessor between you and your Lord subhanahu, who cannot even help themselves, is not permissible in Islam, and it takes you out of the fold of Islam. You cannot pray to the dead saints. You cannot pray to the dead fasiqs. You cannot pray to the prophets, alayhim zafatul salatu wasalam. You cannot pray to the angels. You cannot pray to the trees. You cannot pray to the rocks. You cannot pray to the rats. You cannot pray to the temples or the or your pictures or your family members, whoever, whatever you're praying to, you cannot pray except to Allah. La ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. There is no God worthy of worship except Allah, and Muhammad is his last prophet and messenger, alayhi afdal salatu wasalam. So Muslims do not worship the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The third nullifier of Islam is whoever does not declare those who associate partners with Allah to be disbelievers, or doubt in their disbelief, or affirm their way of disbelief, have left the fold of Islam. What does this mean? This means for those people, and I can remember running into some of our brothers and sisters in America because of their complete ignorance of the religion. They were a part of particular jama'at, particular groups, almost sects or groups in the religion, and they believed honestly. I remember one particular brother, he was the imam of a particular community in my city, a community of people totally ignorant, but they had a love for Islam. And they said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. But this person who's being in a position of leadership, he said to me once, he said, hey, the Jews and the Christians, they're our brothers in faith. You know, we can't call them disbelievers. Wa'iyadu billah min dhalika. Why do I mention this very important point? Because there are people who say that we have one religion, we're single faith, wahdata adyan, our religion is one, we can sit together, we can try to come up with solutions together, we are one. No, absolutely not. Any practicing Christian even, or priest, especially people in leadership, who's really sincere about their principles, will know they cannot sit with the Muslims because they believe we are misguided and we believe they are misguided. Islam is pure. And Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, declared Jews and Christians of this day and age, those during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam who did not accept his message, to be disbelievers. And I'll just give you one simple ayat. I mean, there's tons of ayats in the Quran alone. Then you could go to the Sunnah and you'll find tons of evidence for this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Kitabi al-Kareem in Surah Al-Bayyinah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Isn't that enough for us? Verily those, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, verily those who disbelieve. What do they disbelieve in? They disbelieve in the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as the people before them disbelieved in the message of Jesus, and they disbelieved in the message of Moses, and they disbelieved in the message of Abraham, and they disbelieved in the message of Prophet Lot or Lut, and all the other prophets who were sent with a message, and Nuh, all the way to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. They disbelieved in them, so they're in the hellfire forever. Inna alladhina kafaru, verily those who disbelieve. Min ahl al-kitab, who is ahl al-kitab? Ahl al-kitab is the Jews and the Christians. Wal mushrikeen, and who are the mushrikeen? Anyone else. Anyone else besides Muslims who don't believe in Islamic monotheism, they're considered polytheists. Why? Because they might worship rocks, they might worship trees, they might worship Shiva, they might worship Buddha, they might worship one of the many Hindu gods, they might worship a tree, they might worship the elephant, they might worship a cow, they might worship a rat, they might worship body parts, they might worship like the pagan, the Wiccans, they might be the, all this Illuminati people who worship jinn and so forth like this, and shayateen, they might be any of those. They're all mushriks. They're all considered what in Islam? They're considered mushrikeen. They're considered those people, they're polytheists because they associate partners with Allah or they worship others besides Allah in totality. So, Allah makes takfir of them. Allah declares them disbelievers. So we as Muslims, because we believe in the Quran and we believe in the Sunnah, we say they're disbelievers. End of story. Number four, the fourth type of nullifier of Islam is whoever believes that guidance other than that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is more complete than his guidance, or that ruling by other than it is better than his rulings. Like those who prefer the rulership of oppressive transgressors over the rulership of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So there is so much tafsir, there's so many details, but we'll just keep it concise for other lectures in the future to let us know that the best guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to challenge that principle is disbelief and takes you out of the fold of Islam. Don't, as a Muslim, say that, yeah, well, I know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has a beautiful sunnah, but Imam so-and-so has a nice sunnah too. Or my sheikh so-and-so has a really nice madhab or sunnah, which is over the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah. Or our ideology or our government or our style of rulership is better than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's style of guidance, rulership, and authority. وَعْيَادَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. All of that takes you out of the fold of Islam. And تَبِي يَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ. The fifth thing which takes a person out of the fold of Islam, these are just... Also, we have to be aware that these 10 nullifiers of faith, there are so many, many more. But these are the, what you could say, the main ones that Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned them in a treatise that he wrote about this topic. And Sheikh Ahmed is just really making it concise from the Sheikh's treatise, or really just rehashing or restating the Sheikh's treaties in his own treaties here. And that this is what the Sheikh mentioned. But if you go to Imam Nawawi's books in fiqh, for example, I believe Majmu' or some of the other books that Imam Nawawi has, and many of the fuqaha, they have a bab, they have a chapter entitled the Bab al-Ridda, or the chapter of apostasy, where they mention many, some of them they count, they say there's hundreds of ways to apostate from the religion. So we have to be careful. So don't think that this also came from Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Abedin, this is what the fuqaha, this is if you believe yourself to be a follower of Abu Hanifa, or Imam Abu Hanifa, or Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi'i, or Imam Ahmed, or any of the great Imams in Islam, you'll find this. This is what they had consensus, ijma' upon, that a person can enter Islam and a person can leave Islam. So we have to be careful. And it isn't just because they said the Shahada without believing in it that they enter Islam. And it isn't simply because they say the Shahada but they do acts of disbelief that take them out of the fold of Islam that they remain Muslims. No, that's not the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his religion to the messengers alayhim afdhal salatu wa salam. This is what we learn from Kitabillah wa Sunnat Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you can enter Islam and you can leave Islam, and we have to be cautious. Wa'iyadu billah min dhalika. And the fifth thing, so whoever hates a thing that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent with, even if he acts upon it. So if you hate something from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if you practice it, for example, some people, maybe they hate Salat. He says, I hate praying. I'm tired of it. But I'm going to do it because it's from Islam. That's kind of what the thing is. You know, it's a social gathering. When I go to the masjid, I see the brothers or whatever. Or, you know, I'm tired of praying. Why do I got to do it five times a day? Whatever the case is. If they hate something from Islam, that's established from Islam, they hate it, then this is disbelief. It takes them out of the fold of Islam. So we have to check ourselves. Check ourselves. Understand the prayer. Once you understand, wallahi ilm, al-ilm, al-ilm qabla al-qawli wal-amal, knowledge precedes actions and doing. The more knowledge you have, the more you understand, and you'll find the delicious, the beauty of salat. That when you go, you actually see, wow. Especially when you're having a stressful day and you really get a chance, and you can appreciate that, especially also in a non-Muslim society too. When you have all these outside pressures and everything around you, you are living in an un-Islamic environment. And then you go to the masjid and it's like you just, your heart is opened up. It's a refreshing, it's rejuvenation in your iman and your brotherhood. You see your brothers from everywhere and you cooperate with them and you pray together. One of the highest duties you can do is praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, coming closer to your Lord. Or you feel you're depressed or you're having difficulty in your life. And just to take that time out and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, coming closer to your Lord. That's a thamarat al-ilm. Al-amal, thamarat al-ilm. That actions are the fruits of knowledge. This is why we seek the knowledge. Talib al-ilm, faridatun ala kulli muslim. Seeking the knowledge is an obligation upon all the Muslims. So be careful, brothers and sisters, to not hate something that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. Sixth thing, whoever mocks something from the religion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so making fun of something from the Sunnah, making fun of something from the Quran. So the seventh thing, magic, and it involves charms, spells used to split the husband and wife, and spells that induce, you know, as we say, love potions, that cause people to love you or what have you, to increase love. All these kind of spells and magic and witchcraft and sorcery is disbelief, takes you out of the fold of Islam. And tebi, stay away from the palm readers, stay away from the fortune tellers, the crystal ball readers, the tarot card readers, and all this stuff, and even the horoscopes. Avoid all of it. It all is kufr, and it all will only take you to the hellfire, because you'll begin to believe some of the truths that those people have gotten from the jinn. They've gotten that from a world of the unseen, yes. We believe that some of those things that they bring is true. Otherwise, no one would ever follow them. They might know your name. They might know some details about you. They might know certain facts that they got from the world of the unseen, which is a dangerous world. Be careful of the jinn. The eighth thing we need to be cautious of, which is takes you out of the fold of Islam, helping polytheists and cooperating with them against Muslims. So helping disbelievers against believers. وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. The ninth thing is the belief that some people are absolved from following the legislator of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So thinking, for example, and I just got to quickly mention this because you have some groups that they believe their imams have so much taqwa, and they even try to use some of the verses in the Quran. They use an ayat where Allah says, "Hatta balagha yaqeen," basically about worshiping Allah until you get yaqeen. They say yaqeen to them means that you get to a certain level and status in your worship and piety. You no longer have to pray. You no longer have to observe the halal and the haram. It's all good for you. This is what some extreme Sufis believe. And it's true, you can't deny it. Go to some of those Sufi sheikhs. You have them in America, we have them in Hadramaut, we have them here, and we have them all over the world. You just ask them about this ayat. So, some people believe that they no longer have to follow Islam. They're no longer, even though the Prophet ﷺ was better than all of them, and better than all of their walis, and the Sahaba were better than all their people who they believe are so holy and great. And all of them worshipped Allah until they died. And the Mufassireen, the people of Tafsir, they say, yaqeen here, it means death. So we worship Allah until we die, till we enter the grave, until our amal is done in this life. So we're responsible for following the Sharia, and people who believe that they no longer have to practice Islam, they've left the fold of Islam. The tenth thing that we have to be cautious of is rejecting the religion of Allah and not attempting to learn and practice it. So anyone who remains ignorant and doesn't want to, they refuse to even learn how to pray properly or to make tahara, to purify themselves properly. They refuse it. Maybe they live in a Muslim society and it's all around them is knowledge, but they totally reject it. No, I'm busy. I'm doing business. No, I'm busy. I have my family and I have this. No one is taken away from that. But there are certain obligatory duties, things that make you, that's what makes you a Muslim. It wasn't a birthright. It wasn't because your name was Muhammad or your name was Fatima or your name is Khalid, your name is Fulan or Fulania. That's not what made you a Muslim. It's your belief. It's your creed. And that's the importance of this risala. And I ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad.